Sorry about that.
Sorry. All right, everybody ready?
Yes, Mr. Hearing Officer, this time, Mr. Whitfield.
Wait, I'm altering.
You are.
Okay, sorry.
Mr. Hearing Officer, this time, Mr. Whitfield's case rests.
All right, thank you, Mr. Dale. Mr. Butler, is there any rebuttal?
Yes, sir, I'm going to call Sheriff Piper in the bottom.
Afternoon, Sheriff. Raise your right hand. You swear the testimony you're about to give in this hearing will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God.
I do.
Have a seat, Mr. Butler.
Sheriff Piper, can you please introduce yourself to the board?
Duane Piper, Sheriff for Forsyth County.
When did you take office?
January 1st, 2013.
Can you explain to the board any changes you have made in, I guess, the human resources area of your office?
Not a lot of changes, we're staying more involved in the human resources action, the human resources function than the previous sheriff probably did. Policy-wise, what are you asking?
Well, no, just in general, I'm sorry. Does your office have its own set of policies?
We do.
And who establishes or approves those policies?
I approve. They're established through legal research, meeting with command staff and research by our internal affairs. Come up with our policies, and then they're approved through a staff process, and then I sign off on the file.
There's a stack of papers in front of you with some blue stickers on them. If you could find the one labeled FC10, please. And I'll direct your attention to policy 2-7.203 on the second page.
I didn't run the last one.
Sorry. Can you tell the board what this policy here is?
It's a policy for dismissal, for disciplinary reasons, and come up with just by the same method they told you about a minute ago.
Now, is it your desire when you come up with these new policies to be consistent with the principles of the civil service board?
Yes, we stay as close as we can to what the county's policies are and the civil service policies, with a recognition that this is a law enforcement agency, county policy, and every other county policy actually throughout the county, including civil service policies, were not made specifically for law enforcement, nor by anybody that was in law enforcement. Any slight deviations went to great pains to stay consistent and understand the reasons for the policies and accomplish those reasons in a law enforcement setting.
And can you explain to the board, well, let me ask you this, are your deputies covered by the county civil service office?
Oh, yes.
Okay. And what are your thoughts on that?
I think it's one of the valuable tools we have for employee morale and for their protection. It's, in my mind, pretty much indispensable that we have civil service protection for adverse job action for employees.
I couldn't hear you.
I think it's essential that we have civil service protection for employees for adverse job actions.
Can you explain to the board, let me ask you this. As sheriff, are you knowledgeable on how your office is associated with or tied to the county government?
Yes.
Okay. Can you explain that distinction to the board, please?
In what way? There's a whole lot of ways that we're not tied to the county government. I'll give you my distinction if there's anything that you want to know, if you want to clarify or know. Sheriff's office, like other constitutional offices, is a separate constitutional office. I have responsibilities to the public outside of what the county and the Board of Commissioners have. They have oversight of the sheriff's office in that they set the budget. It's a financial oversight, but in my view, that at the end of the oversight, that the county commission have the sheriff's office.
Can the county commission tell you how to run your office?
No, they never tried.
All right. Are you familiar with the investigation into Paul Whitfield, the most recent IA investigation?
I am. The one for the termination?
Yes, the untruthfulness.
Yes, I am.
How did you become aware of that investigation?
I ordered it. It's actually a spinoff from a criminal investigation that was going on. We had some information. It came obvious to us that the suspect that we arrested for quite a large theft and other illegal activities had gotten some advanced information that the investigation was going on and that we would be coming to serve search warrants. The result of the search warrant, we got some electronic devices from her. Stopping people in her business and going here again. We got some electronic devices from her and got quite an impressive list of people, both in law enforcement and other places of other prominent people have been in contact with this particular suspect. The law enforcement people were an immediate concern to no indication at that time that any of the folks that we talked to in our agency had actually spoken improperly to this person or had given any information they shouldn't have to this person. But due diligence and frankly my responsibility, we were going to find out. So we talked to quite a few people involved, and Mr. Whitfield's had a voicemail on there. In a recent time, we're looking at people mainly who've had lots of contact with her over a period of time, or recent contact in the time of the investigation. And Mr. Whitfield is one of those.
Once the Internal Affairs completed their investigation, were you made aware of the findings?
I was. Actually, I stayed aware of the findings as they were going. This is of particular interest because we had law enforcement officers that had the potential to have been doing things even potentially illegal. So I stayed updated pretty much as things were going.
At the conclusion of that investigation, did you have the opportunity to review the entire case file of the investigation itself?
I did, except for the actual in writing part, the last part with the polygraph and the results coming from that. I was actually not in town, and that was verbal, but you did.
In front of you, you have another document labeled FC-11.
Yes.
If you'll turn to the second page of FC-11.
Third page?
Second page, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
All right. What document is that, Sheriff?
This is a disciplinary action recommendation.
Okay. It's been pointed out that your signature is not on this particular document.
It is not.
Can you explain that, please?
I wasn't in town.
You were out of town?
I was out of town. Legally, I have a chief deputy, a name designated chief deputy. I think it was July of 2012, they changed the laws on succession for sheriff, become incapacitated in office or leave office for any reason, and name the chief deputy. That rather than go through the appointment process that they used to go through, now the chief deputy becomes sheriff, so he has full authority, my full authority, in my absence, in my direction.
And on this particular day, May 30th, reference on this disciplinary action recommendation form, did Chief Giordano have your full authority to authorize the termination?
He did. There's many conversations about it.
Did you have conversations that day with him?
Oh, yeah.
How did you have those conversations?
By phone. Okay.
All right. Can you explain to the board why you, well, let me ask you this. You said you authorized Chief Giordano to do the termination and sign the form. Did you agree with the decision to terminate Mr. Whitfield?
I did.
All right, can you explain for what reasons you agreed the termination was appropriate?
As I said, I was aware of what was going on before I left town. I don't remember what day I left town. I think this, if I remember right, this was probably a Friday. have to look back at county. But to the first part, it's gotten long. The investigation has gotten long, longer than I like for it to happen, scheduling things. I think when you have a disciplinary action, you need to handle it quickly. Otherwise, you're not to stay away from me here. I just lost track of what you asked me.
I guess I was asking the reasons you concurred the termination was appropriate for Mr. Whitfield.
Okay. From the first interview, speaking with the internal hearing investigators, the chief and I were together when we had the briefings on those.
I'm sorry, I can't hear you very well.
The first part of the investigation, from the initial interview that the internal hearing investigators had with Mr. Whitfield, it was obvious that he was being, at the very minimum, attempting to mislead or not tell us everything. A bit of a surprise. In my mind, we were just tying up loose ends. Did not think that he had done anything improper at that point until he just went right to obfuscation, I guess is the best word. He tried not to answer questions or untruthful answering questions specifically, and that he initially said that he had not left any voice messages for this particular suspect. And then when it became clear that we knew that he had, he started changing the story. Very concerned. At that point, I'm very concerned about it. We talked about it and decided to go ahead and polygraph to see if he was going to be informed. No determination had been made yet. But then by the time we got around to the polygraph, and without ever being hooked up to the polygraph machine, he came forward with more information that he had actually spoken to this suspect very soon after his internal affairs interview. At that point, unless some new information had come up, I was confident that I was going to get a recommendation for termination from there.
Now, the dismissal policy, which is labeled as FC-10, that we had you identify earlier, it states that dismissal for disciplinary reasons may be instituted without prior notice when deemed necessary to protect the agency or the employee concerned.
Which paragraph?
It's a 2-7.203.
It's a part of the
number A, the very first sentence. First paragraph of A, first sentence.
Okay.
And it says that you can institute dismissal.
Objection. You're leading. Ask him about the policy if he knows it.
Objection is leading question.
Yeah. I am reading directly off an admitted exhibit, which I can do, so that I can ask him a question.
All right. Okay.
Policy says, dismissal for disciplinary reasons may be instituted without prior notice when deemed necessary to protect the agency or the employee concerned. There's been testimony that Mr. Whitfield
objected as to leading and him repeating testimony.
Fine.
Rephrase the question.
Did Mr. Whitfield get prior notice before May 30th that he was going to be terminated?
As I said, I was out of town, but I was advised of the process. How it occurred, make sure that Chief Deputy would be no problems, everything was done correctly. And yes, Major Hoffman conducted a pre-dismissal interview, a pre-dismissal meeting with him before they went into the actual dismissal. And the thing that sticks in my mind, what I remember most clearly, was that during the pre-dismissal part of it, Mr. Whitfield seemed to think that this was some type of negotiation rather than pre-dismissal. His words were, I thought this was a negotiation. I remember that specific part.
As sheriff, do you have any concerns had Major Hoffman told Mr. Whitfield, we're going to meet tomorrow to talk about, to do your pre-dismissal conference, to give him that type of prior notice? Would you have any concerns?
Absolutely. Any sworn officer, I would be. Won't find me putting the policies together saying sworn officers who have the power to arrest or otherwise adversely affect the public or anybody else. be advised beforehand, any large amount of time, that they're going to be terminated. Don't know what that's going to do to their state of mind. Don't know, there's too much we don't know. So all we're there on the sudden caution.
And in a case such as this, where you at least had concerns that confidential information was being disclosed, would that factor into your decision on whether or not you're going to give a lot of advance notice?
We were absolutely certain confidential information was disclosed. We don't know by, we wonder by Mr. Whitfield that might know of at this point, but we do know it was disclosed, yes.
Now, was, you know who Ms. Pat Carson is? Was Ms. Carson notified of Mr. Whitfield's dismissal prior to him being terminated?
No, we didn't notify her until afterwards.
Okay. And why did you not do that?
We're not notifying county's HR at this point of adverse job actions, especially termination type, because we've had some information circulated prior to the action being taken. We've had some problems with that. I'm certain that it came out of Ms. Carson's office, but we've had a couple of terminations that were, one specifically was the one catalyst for changing the way we were communicating to the county. Information was leaked by either Ms. Carson, somebody in her office, or one of two employees in our office, who have since been moved out of any position where they know what was happening personnel-wise, because it was just other people working with the person about to be terminated knew about it before he ever knew about it. That's not good for the employee, it's not good for anybody. Okay.
Since you made, reason,
people are talking about stuff we shouldn't be talking about.
Since you've made those changes, are you aware of any other person who's going to have an adverse employment action being made aware of it prior to them being told?
Actually, since we made the change, no, there's been nothing, been no leaks at all. Actually, Mr. Huggins was sending an open record request on that terminated employee before the termination ever happened.
So what was he asking for?
He wanted the personnel order where the person was being terminated. He hadn't been terminated.
And you hadn't terminated that person yet? And you were getting open records requests on
yes.
that?
Yes. It was serious enough we had to do something.
Objection. Collateral. Not about Paul Whitfield. I'm happy to go in to find out about other people's terminations if the hearing officer wishes.
Well, I think he's just explaining why he instituted this new policy, so I'm overruled the objection.
To the best of your knowledge, Sheriff, were your sheriff's office policies regarding dismissals of your employees followed in Mr. Whitfield's case?
They were.
Is there anything else you'd like to tell the board since you're here that I haven't called to ask you about? Thank you, Chair.
I'm going to need a minute. Paul Whitfield's termination before he was terminated?
No, sir.
What did you just say?
For the previous employee, somewhere around March, April, I'd have to look back. Somewhere in the spring, earlier in the year, we were terminating another employee.
Okay.
And Mr. Huggins, with an open records request for a personnel order, wasn't on. But for this employee's termination, he hadn't been terminated yet.
Who was that?
Do I want to say the name?
Yeah, I want to know who it is.
Sure.
Go ahead.
Jamie Wright.
Jamie Wright. So you're saying that he had asked for an open records act request prior to Jamie Wright's termination, asking for termination papers?
Actually, personnel order.
Personnel order. Does that mean?
Personnel orders outline personnel moves, new hires, termination.
Yeah, but a personnel order is not about a termination necessarily, is it?
This specific one, if I remember correctly, I think he asked for the personnel order to put that termination on. I don't have it from me. I can't remember. I know the catalyst for us.
But this was prior to Mr. Whitfield's termination?
It was prior to his investigation going on.
You never sent an email to Pat Carson expressing any concerns about policy about this, right? You never sent a letter to the Civil Service Board saying, you know what, we don't want to comply with the policy that says that we have to notify HR, county HR, prior to termination, right?
Well, we're not going to try to avoid any policies. So I wouldn't send an email saying we're not going to abide by the policy. We are abiding by the policy.
Well, you didn't abide by the policy in this case because you gave the notice 10 days after Mr. Whitfield was terminated, right?
I'm not aware of a policy that says what I have to do with Ms. Carson.
Okay.
So I think she doesn't work with your office.
Well, let me show you the policy that you have as a result of your being part of the county. Says all department heads and elected officials?
I do.
Okay, and that policy says is that when a safety exception is not applicable, prior notice can range from the end of business day preceding the pre-dismissal meeting to 30 minutes prior notice. You see that? I'm on the third page. The first page, third bullet point. I'm sorry. Second bullet point.
Yes, okay.
You see that? And you did not give, you weren't there at the time that the pre-termination hearing took place, right? Did you have any type of memorandum in this file about your considerations of why he should be terminated? In other words, I don't see anything in this file that shows that you even looked at this file.
That's what I explained earlier. I was just aware of it as it was going in verbal between what you did me.
Not an email?
No.
Not a communication with your own HR department?
No emails from me.
No written correspondence whatsoever?
That's right.
No tape recordings?
From me?
Yeah.
Not that I'm aware of.
No logs on your computer that show that you met with anyone concerning this case?
No, from me.
And you certainly did not give, look at policy 7, separation, page 36, please. This is the civil service policy, the county policy, concerning dismissal. Section 8. Do you see that?
I do.
Okay. It says, if you would read to me, the fourth line in the policy starting with in.
In the event of such dismissal, is that what you mean?
Yes.
In the event of such dismissal, the applicable elected official slash department head shall notify the human resources director no later than the end of the following business day.
Okay. And it says, that's when you have a safety problem, right?
Does it say that in here?
A dismissal shall be instituted without prior notice when deemed necessary to protect the county or the employee concerned. In the event of such a dismissal, the applicable elected official shall notify the HR director no later than the end of the following business day. Do you see that?
That's what it said, yes.
And you didn't do it?
No, we didn't.
So you violated the policy?
This is not my policy.
But you violated this policy?
No, this is not my policy. This is county policy.
So you violated the county's policy?
This is from the county manager. This is not my policy.
So the county manager, in this is a separation policy that applies to all employees who are separated from employment with Forsyth County. And it says elected official in this policy, does it not?
It does. It says that.
But you don't want to follow that policy. Is that your testimony?
No, we made our own policies that are consistent with the way it says we can do the civil service.
If Sheriff,
those are the ones.
Consistent means if you have a one-day notification, then it's consistent with their one-day notification, right?
Consistent means a whole broad range of things. But to have two policies that folks have to follow, you make it unmanageable.
Oh, I see. So 10 days later, when you actually did give the policy, the termination paperwork, I should say, to the county, that was manageable.
I'm not familiar with what we gave it to the county.
Well, let me ask you to assume that the county got it 10 days after the dismissal.
Okay.
It also says in this policy, you do receive the county's money, do you not?
In a budget at the beginning of every
month. And your employees do receive benefits, right?
They do.
Do you receive health insurance through the county?
I do.
Do you receive benefits through the county?
Yes.
Do you not accept those benefits?
I do.
Do you get paid by the county when you take sick leave?
Actually, it comes out of my budget. Sheriff's budget.
Is it your personal pocketbook
No.
that's being picked?
Sheriff's office budget.
Okay.
Sheriff's office budget.
And who funds that? People?
Yes.
How do they fund it?
Through taxes.
Right. And you take that money, and it's administered through the county?
Correct. Yes.
It also says, in all other cases, let's read, look at it with me. It also says, however, in other cases, the applicable elected official should notify the human resources director of his or her intent to dismiss an employee at the reasons therefore prior to dismissal. You see that?
I see that.
Did you notify Pat Carson of the reasons prior to dismissal?
We did not.
Mentioned earlier in your testimony that you were still concerned to this day that Paul Whitfield had leaked confidential information to Ms. Pruitt.
No, I think that's the opposite of what I said.
So you have no concern that Mr. Whitfield ever leaked information?
I have concerns now.
Now?
Following when you started asking him questions, at the beginning I didn't have any concerns, but when you start dodging, there's a reason for dodging. It raised concerns in my mind at that point, yes.
But those were unfounded concerns.
I don't know that. It could be, they could not be. Those once we get to where the leaks came from, that will actually be in a criminal setting. It will be in.
Okay, so let me understand.
There's still under investigation.
So the real reason then that Mr. Whitfield was terminated was because you have a suspicion that he leaked information?
Absolutely not. The reason he was terminated was for being untruthful and attempting to
let's go through those together. All right. You made the decision to terminate him. Is that what your testimony is today?
I made, actually, I got a recommendation from his supervisor.
I see. So, but you didn't make the decision?
I had to make the final determination. Yes, I had to actually say yes or no. In my stead, the chief deputy does that.
Right. And the chief deputy is what? So let me understand. I got to understand. It was you who made the decision to terminate Paul Whitfield. Yes or no?
Which time? At what point? Initially, it came from Major Hoffman.
I'm talking about the final decision.
The final decision only this.
You don't have to accept that decision.
I don't.
You have complete discretion.
I do.
Let's talk about what you relied upon in making that determination. All right. You said that specifically, he said, initially specifically, that he said he didn't leave voicemails. I believe that was your testimony, wasn't it?
The best recollection of the wording there was, had you ever had occasion, or have you had occasion, or something like that, to leave a voicemail for this particular criminal suspect? And his answer was no.
No, that's not what he said, is it? Did you review
the record? That's my recollection.
Did you review the record?
Not in the last several weeks.
Did you review the record prior to making your determination?
Review the record. I got a briefing from the Internal Affairs Office.
Were you ever presented with this packet of information, which is PW1?
Oh, yeah, this is their summary. This is a transcript here.
Yeah. Were you ever presented with the record?
I never asked for it.
You never asked for it? You didn't think it was important?
No, I got a briefing from an Internal Affairs officer today.
So the fact that this was a man who was with you, your apartment, for over 30 years, you didn't want to look over the transcripts to see exactly what he said, right?
I didn't have any questions about it.
What about the polygraph exam? Tell me how you relied upon that.
Didn't rely upon it at all. I don't even know the results of it.
What about what happened in the polygraph? Did you rely upon anything? I think you said that specifically you said initially he didn't say he didn't leave voicemails. Well, and that you knew he changed his story. Of course, that's not what the record says, but you didn't look at the record.
Is there a question?
You never looked at the record.
I answered that. No, I have not looked at it. I've never looked at that transcript that you showed me.
And then you say that you got some information about his conduct at the polygraph exam, right?
No, verbally.
With who?
Chief Deputy. Okay.
And that would be Giordano?
Yes, actually.
Did you speak with any of the IA investigators about this case?
Throughout the entire thing, different times, yes. I couldn't tell you which ones or which ones are.
Talk to Garrison?
Oh, yeah.
Talk to Boyer?
Yes.
Talk to them on a regular basis?
As regular as necessary.
Any type of documentation that you would have from your office on when you might have met with them?
I don't know where it would come from.
Keep a calendar?
Not for meetings like that.
You don't keep a meetings calendar?
Not for those type of meetings. Those type of meetings happen as things happen.
No communication by email or computer?
Definitely not by email.
No progress report from them in writing?
Not to me.
Okay. Did you ask for any of them?
No.
What did you glean from what he said at the polygraph?
I gleaned that he had a conversation with the criminal suspect very soon after the initial internal affairs interview, and that he didn't tell us about it. And then when he got into the polygraph, he was not hooked up to the machine, so it wasn't actually part of the pre-interview, is my understanding. For the pre-interview, it came up that he said that he had gotten a call from her, and he was asked by the lawyer, did you tell internal affairs? And he said no.
Do you know the orders he received?
I wasn't there, but I know what kind of orders he would get.
Oh, so you know what kind of orders he would get, but you didn't determine what kind of orders he actually got?
He'd been told not to talk about the case with other deputies.
And what was the conversation that he had, Sheriff? I'm sorry.
Before you finish, Sheriff.
I think I'll finish that.
Tell me the substance of the conversation he had with Ms. Pruitt.
I'm sorry?
The substance of Mr. Whitfield's conversation with Ms. Pruitt. That's the one that you just talked about.
Yeah, I was trying not to say her name.
That's okay. It's been all over the record.
The substance of the conversation?
Yes.
Don't remember. What I remember from it was that it was actually a call from another female, if that's already been on the record, and you know her name too, from her phone, and then the phone was given to Ms. Pruitt and the conversation.
Do you have an opportunity to speak with Mr. Whitfield before he was terminated?
I do not.
Would it have made a difference to you?
I don't know. I doubt it.
When you were with IA, did you write memorandums of your investigations?
I sure did, yes. We're talking 15, 16, 17 years ago.
There were other, you had the opportunity to discipline Paul Whitfield in any fashion that you wished, correct?
Yes, thank you.
You had the opportunity to discipline Mr. Whitfield any way you wanted to.
I'm not sure what you're asking.
Well, you terminated him.
Yes.
You didn't have to terminate him.
We're being very consistent. It was a truthfulness issue, and we're terminating
him. I see. You yourself have had problems with truthfulness in the past, haven't you?
I haven't.
You haven't. Not even when you were with Glynn County? Let me show you a document about truthfulness.
Can I have this mark, please?
You were a captain at St. Simon's Island, were you not?
Absolutely not. No, I'm not a captain.
I'm sorry. You were a patrolman?
Yes.
You worked for W.R. Pittman, did you not?
I'm not sure.
Let me show you the give you a reflection of the recollection.
We're over 20 years ago.
I'm going to show you what's marked for purposes of recollection, PW13 at this time.
Do you have a copy of that, sir?
I do.
Thank you.
In fact, let me go ahead and mark it as PW13 and ask you to identify it.
Yes, I'm sorry, I didn't remember Captain Pittman's name.
Okay.
Yeah, I do remember that.
Tell us about being truthful back then when you were a patrolman at the Glynn County Police Department.
I called in sick for work and went and played in a golf tournament and received an 8-hour suspension.
Okay, so you lied about that, did you not?
No, they asked me what I did, and I told them, and I got an 8-hour suspension.
Well, you also had another warning, did you not? You appealed it, by the way, did you not?
Oh, absolutely, I did.
Okay. You said that you were appealing the severity of your punishment for calling in sick to work on 2-17-90. My past record of attendance, 13 months without use of any sick days, along with my job performance, should be taken into consideration when determining punishment. Do you see that?
I do.
Okay. You were accused, were you not, of taking a sick day to play golf, were you not?
He's been asked and answered. He's asked him about this incident. Sheriff Piper's already explained it. I don't know why we need to keep going into it.
Go ahead.
I was called accused.
Sheriff, let me rule on the objection. Objection is sustained. Go ahead and ask your next question.
You also had another situation, did you not?
Not that I remember, but if there was one, I'm sure you're about to tell me about it.
Well, I will. I'm going to show it to you. First of all, I'd like to move for the admission of PW13.
I don't know the relevance of this here. Outside of the testimony that was asked, I don't know the document needs to be admitted.
Let me see the document. what is the purpose of the admission?
Mr. Lavelle?
The relevance?
Well, are you asking it to be admitted for impeachment?
Yes.
He asked you, how are you using this to impeach him? I think he answered the question you asked about whether he had ever been suspended or punished.
Well, I think it also goes towards consistency in the way he views things in the disciplinary process. He is the sole determinant as to what is going to happen and not happen when somebody is involved in a deception, an alleged deception. This goes towards his prior conduct, and it should affect the civil service's view of the severity of the punishment. It goes towards severity, and because he himself was involved in a situation very similar, where he was accused of something, and the severity was appealed, and the severity was very little, a lot less. I believe it goes towards his motivation of being unfavorable.
It absolutely does not. We're talking about things from over 20 years ago, from 1990. We have a staleness issue to begin with. And quite frankly, the relevancy of what did or didn't happen in Glenn County in 1990 had no bearing on what happened to Mr. Whitfield today. The testimony, I think he's done what he's allowed to do through the testimony, but introducing hearsay documents from 1990 is just not relevant in this case.
I don't think they're hearsay documents. He's identified them.
Well, he's identified them. I don't know that they're certified. I'm going to sustain the objection. I think he's testified to the matters that you've asked him about.
So then I'll continue on with showing you PW-14. I show you PW-14. You were accused, were you not, on October the 9th, 1992, of intentionally lying on the phone while you were in the detention center, while the sergeant was at the detention center, that a false statement was left on the voicemail. Look at page 2. Last paragraph.
I'm looking for the rest of this one.
Object to using PW-14. Apparently, it's not a complete document. I see on the front it says other side, and no other side. There's something missing here. Apparently, the witness is confused by that as well.
Let me see.
There are two complete documents in there. Or if you think that the first one is incomplete, the second one is complete.
But it does say other side, is there?
There was some work to do. I believe the other side was a little better.
Stop the middle sentence.
I'm sorry, I do have it here. I'm going to withdraw that document.
All right.
I'm going to resubmit. Yeah, I'm going to withdraw that. I'm going to resubmit it as the October 9th letter alone.
This is going to hand it out. If you have the second page, I'd like to see it.
I don't have a second page. I only have this page of the second page of the document, which is its own document.
So you don't have the backside of the first page?
No, I'm going to just discuss the October 9th letter that you received, which is the reprimand for Investigator Duane Piper, lying to a superior officer.
Which one am I looking at?
Look at the second page only.
Gotcha.
Sheriff, you obviously disagree with the finding that you intentionally left a false statement on the sergeant's voicemail.
I've read the entire thing, trying to jog my memory. I don't remember this.
You don't remember?
I don't think so.
Well, that happened on October the 9th of 1992, according to the letter. You don't, it doesn't jog your memory.
No, it doesn't.
Look at page one just for a moment to refresh your recollection.
Oh, you withdrew page one.
This is
I'm not using it. I'm using it to refresh his recollection. Yes. I want you to look at that, please.
I read the whole thing.
You were not, did that refresh your recollection that you were not to deceive Sergeant Doring? On that morning, you had unusual problems at home?
I cannot even remember this. I don't know anything about this.
So the fact that...
I'm going to object. He's shown a document to Mr. Sheriff Piper. Sheriff Piper doesn't remember it. You can't just keep going over the document. The witness doesn't have personal knowledge of the questions being asked.
Well, let's hear what his question is. Go ahead.
It's important for a police officer to have a full opportunity to know the facts and circumstances that lead up to discipline, isn't it? You have to know what you're being charged with, right?
Oh, yes.
Okay. It's part of your responsibility as the sheriff to allow an employee to fully understand what he's being accused of.
Multiple interviews in which I believe he was told what he was being looked at for him. It actually changed, as I said before. It started off just to find out what he was talking to her about, But then when he went to not tell the truth about it, it went to, you're not telling the truth, why are you telling the truth?
Well, if the packet is incomplete, you would say that that is an invalid packet, wouldn't you?
Which packet are you talking about?
The packet for termination. The packet that was given to him.
I didn't think it was incomplete, was it?
Did you look at it?
I didn't know that time.
So you never even looked at it?
I was out of town.
And you came back when?
I don't remember. I just remember we were on the phone on that one. It didn't get finished before I left. I wasn't happy about that.
So if Giordano had given him an incomplete packet, it would have been invalid, right?
An incomplete packet of what? I'm not sure.
In other words, he wasn't given all the information for the reasons for his termination. It would be an invalid packet.
Well, the termination was for a reason, for truthfulness or lack of truthfulness. That's what the termination is for. The termination is not based on a packet. Termination based on action.
An employee is entitled to know all of the facts that you rely upon when you terminate them, right?
We never were ever told anything about that.
And if you did, that would be a violation of your own policy, wouldn't it?
I guess. What I'm not really sure what you're asking. Are you asking me a question?
I am. I'm asking you, don't you want to have a policy where you give people information that's complete?
Oh, yes.
And if it's not complete, then it's invalid.
No, I would agree with the word invalid. I never want to give somebody something that's incomplete, but that would change the facts of what happened for the terminated person.
I see. So you could then give somebody an incomplete package, and that would be okay.
It would be okay. It'd be a mistake that a coworker would make.
But if it did occur and it wasn't complete, it wouldn't change your mind anyway, would it?
Not if the facts remain the same of what happened. It wouldn't change your mind.
If Paul Whitfield is put back to work by the Civil Service Board, would you reinstate him to the same position that he's in now?
Or I'm not subject to relevance. That's, I guess, predicting an outcome that we don't know yet.
I think he can testify if he has an opinion on it. Go ahead. Repeat the question.
If Paul Whitfield is reinstated to his position in the sheriff's office, would you put him back to work in the same position that he left?
I've not given that any thought. Civil Service Board and have a big ruling.
I think that my question was if. Do you have an opinion as to whether or not you put it back in the same place?
My answer was I haven't given that any thought.
But just a few more questions and I think we'll be ready to go. Mr. Whitfield sent you a letter after he was terminated, asking to see you, part of his appeal. Did you see that?
I got an appeal letter. I don't remember specifically asking to see me. I remember I read the appeal letter. Yes.
On June the 4th, do you recall getting a letter?
Can you give me a number?
It's not there now. I'm just asking if you remember getting one.
I can't tell you what I did on June 4th right now. Unless you're going to show me something. Let's go June 4th.
Did you, you didn't read the June 3rd, 2014 letter. Let me show it to you. I'm just going to give it to you to look at. You refresh.
Yeah, hard to look from there.
Okay. You didn't see him after that, after he was terminated, did you?
I did not.
Did you re-review the record after he sent you this letter?
I did not. Not even.
It indicates that he didn't understand the charges.
Finish my question. Not in writing. I didn't review the written part of the record. The conversation that he achieved.
After he sent you the letter?
After he sent the letter.
Anything memorialized in writing?
No, absolutely not.
Was he originally targeted for termination when you became sheriff?
No.
There was no memorandum that had his name on it about him being laid off or written?
No.
So I just want to understand that you agree that the HR department was not, that is, the county HR department was not notified prior to his termination, Mr. Whitfield's termination, right?
They were not notified, no.
And you also agree that after his termination, it took 10 days for them to receive the notification?
I can't agree with that. I don't know how long it took us to be notified.
That's all I have.
You read your
report. I don't have anything else.
I'm going to change my ruling on this in the interest of the rules of the Civil Service Board, which do not adhere to the strict evidentiary requirements. I'm going to admit this for limited
which
purpose.
Which one is this? I'm sorry.
It's PW13.
Okay.
The limited purpose of relevance on punishment. Sheriff's.
Am I allowed to clarify what I said about that, though? I do recall that incident specifically.
Yeah. Does any attorney have any questions?
Well, sure. If you'd like to clarify that, go ahead, Sheriff.
I called in sick and played golf, and I was asked what I did that day. There was no misdirection or anything else. I said, I went and played golf. And I said, well, you're getting suspended for that. And I took my 8-hour suspension. I appealed it and asked them to reconsider how severe it was because I've been missing time. And they said, no, I took my time. I think it attempted to be characterized as misleading somebody. They was asked about it, and I told them what I did.
And so, really and truly, though, you know the importance of a full and fair investigation.
Asked and answered.
Nuts. He's on cross.
I do, but that was a quick one. They asked me, I told him.
All right. Any questions by members of the board?
Do you have a question?
Yeah, just a couple of questions. First of all, Sheriff, I want to commend you for the number of years of service you've had to this county. You've worked here in several capacities, quite some time. Appreciate especially the job you and your command staff did in your department with courthouse units. Just got a couple questions I'd like to ask, just very direct questions. The long and short of it is, why was Mr. Whitfield fired?
Because he wasn't being truthful or asking questions about his communications with a person who just arrested for serious felonies.
You stated that you're, with the exception of the six appointed members of your command staff, that civil service protection is important. Sheriff's office employees.
That's absolutely vital.
in your opinion, do you feel like the civil service policy was followed in this particular situation?
I do. I've not been told or shown anything legally that anybody by command staff or by chain of command failed to follow our policy.
Thank you, Sheriff.
I do have a question, Sheriff.
Yes, sir.
We've known each other for a long time.
Yes.
I have two questions. Your command staff did not follow the civil service guidelines for whatever reason and whatever you want to say, but based on the guidelines that this board has used in the past, it was not followed. First of all, there was not a checklist placed on the packet, and that's part of it, and that was violated. And second of all, according to the civil service guidelines, you were required, your command staff, not you, but your command staff, was required to submit to the Human Resource Department within 24 hours after the firing of Mr. Whitfield. That was not followed. Those two things were not followed. The thing that I'm most concerned about is that in all the days of working with the Sheriff's Department, I've been on this board for over 20 years, the Sheriff's Department, while they have had human resource people within the department, there's never been a human resource department set up the way that you're setting it up. And I understand a lot of the motives of why you explained one of those about leaks and all that. But in setting that up, and I'm not opposed to you setting it up if you go through the proper channels. Now, I don't know exactly what those proper channels are, whether it's to go to the Board of Commissioners or what. Some way or the other, it should be legitimate supplies so that all employees are under the same guidelines. Now, I'm going to tell you now, and I may not should say this, but this board has never been as concerned about the notification of termination, pre-dismissal hearing, especially in the Sheriff's Department because of the reasons that have been cited. I would never say that the civil service guideline was violated because of that, because of the people you deal with have weapons. Now, I know the rules have been changed, but the other guidelines need to be standardized with the county. I don't know how you're going to do that, and you can go back and talk to your human resource people. Lori Conrad should have known that a checklist should have been attached to the packet. Doesn't seem like a major thing, but you see what happens. The person that's terminated, he and his team are going to use that as one of the items that wasn't followed. The other one was that, as of it stands today, your command staff was obligated to send Ms. Carson the notification. Now the board hasn't met and we haven't decided how this is going to turn out. But those two you did violate. So I'm concerned and I would encourage you that you get with your command staff and you get with the powers to be so that if you want to set up on your own human resource department, I don't oppose that, but it needs to be in a guideline and in such a manner that there would be no conflict between the two.
Any other questions? No. All right. May the sheriff be excused.
Please.
Thank you very much, Sheriff. Any further witness?
Nothing further.
Either was. Need some time before you begin closing arguments, Jim.
Maybe just 2 minutes to get my papers started.
All right, we'll wait 5 minutes.